Blog Talk Radio.
Yo, 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 what's up, world? It's Badass Thugging like I usually do. And you better turn it up, bust some speakers out, cause we off the motherfucking cuff. You dig how we do it? Dog Pound Gangsters 2000 and beyond.
Yo, yo, check this out. This is your girl, Cola Boke, and I'm chilling with my boys right here on Off the Cuff Radio. We off the cuff right now. You dig?
What's up? It's your boy, Lil Yappa, UNLV, ragging up from the river, cooling with my homies and my family at Off the Cuff Radio. Y'all be sure to tune in on Fridays and get the latest scoop and find out what's happening. You wait me?
Tiffany Levine.
And it's Queen Crazy, your girl's favorite bartender.
And we're from
Sex on the Rocks Podcast.
Alright, you're now tuning in to Off the Cuff Radio.
Yeah, because they keep representing that world hip hop. Well, much love.
Alright.
Giving a shout out to the live show on Friday nights, Off the Cuff Radio. And I'm live from the 704. Make sure y'all tune in for the blazing hot music.
Hey y'all, this is Stacey Lachey giving a shout out to King Eric and Off the Cuff Radio.
What's shaking, y'all? This is the Grand, one half of Lost Cause and one third of that Drive Time thing. Sending my love to the homies over at Off the Cuff Radio. Tune in every Friday night for some real deal hip hop conversation. These dudes are the connoisseurs of this thing. You already know what it is. BX stand up, Hud City was shaking. Peace.
Yo, this is Joe Fresh Design, and y'all tuned in to the most raw, uncut show on radio, the Guillotine Team, Off the Cuff. And yo, Eric Sandman, off of these clowns.
Revolution won't be televised, but it will be a revolution. And here's the soundtrack.
Black, brown, red, yellow, white, take flight, fuck a red light. Go! I'm on that Mortal Kombat fight. The power, all them cowards in three-piece suits, denying you your rights. Black Panther midnight, they in my sight. Wow. Fooling you to believe you free to choose what we need to do is address all these unfair institutions with pistols, shooting, demanding restitution for me and you, and let them see what me and my people been through.
Man, Stevie Wonder ain't even have to open his eyes for him to see it was time to uprise. All the drugs, thugs, holler tip slugs, Crips and bloods, but ain't enough hugs.
Nah.
And that's the reason for that mean mug.
As the sun becomes black and the moon bloody red, everybody won't go heaven, but don't nobody dead. No time for being scared, the revolution has came. Brought by SmackWater, Kayla Mayne, and Kendrick James. With 44 more other soldiers baptized in the streets. Said I'm riding with my niggas, Icy Rush and Tay-Z. So you know I keep 316s of spoken word. I am Caleb Israel, the God,
the slum lord.
So for certain, I check the alternatives. Your choices have permanence. Decipher with discernment. Make sure it's indisputable, impeccably irrefutable, unmistakably immutable, absolutely indubitable, unequivocal, undeniable. It's already understood. That secondhand information, we ain't taking it. It ain't good. I say trust me, but verify, affirm and ascertain. It's been weighed and measured, so don't go against the grain.
My nigga, I'm losing. Better than shooting. All that shit's insured. My horse bored with boosting. Trying winning, we losing. These battles and bruises. Turn us loony, my goblins be goony. Acting George Clooney. Cause y'all ain't trying to help us. You always kept us. Rape our women. We speak and y'all check us. Now we wild and reckless. Coming out Houston, Texas. Guard your necklace.
Spread your weight and pressure. Politics here. Live blitz. Passing a mask in the past. They moving reckless. Blasting the gas to harass the protesters. perplexed cause we stood together. Ain't no
father's poor boy saw the struggle to the soundtrack to the revolution. Hard times, politician lives, constitution wise, no restitution. Got me selling dope, baby, I'm boosting. Little bro, raw, sister, prostitution. Red game, institution, all CNI, distribution. Dope game got me insane, tried to get a job to stop confusion. Paid $8 for working on, made an A in math, I'm losing. Now I'm taking gifts, they refusing. Rap game, Huey Newton, equal rights, disillusion. Soundtrack to the revolution.
Clap a Karen, punch a king. Donald Trump don't like y'all. Fucking men. Niggas need to pay attention, learn what we up against. These the ones they wanna get, eliminate them wannabes. Salute to all my ally friends. If you white, you better speak. Disrespect, you better fight. Touch one of us, you better shoot. Use your privilege, motherfucker. Help these brothers get some juice. Time is now. No second guessing. Time to choose right when you choose. See, everybody go when we call them out. And this time around, the brothers won't lose.
Fuck George and Ronald. Mitch McConnell and Donald. I think they lied about Apollo. I think like I am an apostle. Tap into it, it's a message, listen. You can't see it on the television. This a revolution master. This a retribution bastard.
Yeah, this our reparations. This our mule and our 48.
What it do, y'all? This is OTCF in the building. That's Off the Cuff Radio for those that don't know. My name is T-Max with the facts, of course, with the head host, King Eric the Ruler, our co-host in spirit, a lot of Sandman, Lady Chinchilla, hosted by Core Financial, Jesse's Boutique, Dirty Basement Radio, and of course, our very good friend, Cocaine. You know, shout out to the OG, Mighty Cocaine Man. You know, and we are live and direct for this Friday night, and we are on the air with a very, 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 very special guest tonight. This dude, as you heard from his opening track, is one of the most, I mean, obviously, you hear from this song, this man has revolution on his mind and changes his name, you know, and he's definitely got all the intellect in his brain ready to share with us, man. Look, let's give it up for the one, the only, SmackWater, y'all. What it do? What it do?
Hey, what's up with it, man?
What's going on with you, man? Great to have you on, man. We're happy to have you.
Man, it's great to be on. It's great
definitely,
to be on Off the Cuff Radio, man.
Yes, man. Look. One thing about us, man, is that we're always, you know, as you've heard about us, as King has told you, you know, we're always about, you know, bringing those on the show, you know, giving that spotlight to those who really were ferocious on the mic and always about handling business. And look, man, definitely from that opening cut, you know, you got, man, I mean, you definitely, you know, you and your crew was definitely all business in terms of social political commentary, everything that was going on about what's going on in society and everything, man. So, I mean, it's great to have you. Tell us a little bit about yourself.
Oh, well, yeah, you know, for everybody that don't know that's been hiding under a rock or stuck in a cave or something, you know, SmackWater, realest nigga on the gram, king of common sense, you know. They also call me the nigga who go viral every day. one of the most controversial figures that's on social media today, you know. I talk that shit.
Look, man, I mean, and look, if you that laxative for learning, you know, they got to drop the shit on them to make them understand how real it is in the field, man, you know, that's the most essential. I mean, so tell us a little bit about where you're from, you know, what inspired you in the game of hip-hop, you know, everything, man. We got a couple hours, so, I mean, you know,
yeah.
Hey, let's get it.
Yeah, I'm out of H-Town, man, Houston, Texas, man, you know, dirty South. You know, I've been around for a minute, been in this game. You know, in and out of it, because, you know, I've been in and out of life situations, vacation, penitentiary, but I've been doing this music for a long time. It's just a part of me. You know, it's part of my DNA. My grandfather, Grammy Award-winning blues singer, ambassador of blues, he's the only American artist to perform in Russia during the Cold War. And, you know, so I got it honest. And, you know, I just, hip-hop just came easy, man. For I remember when I heard Suck MCs, Run DMC, man, I was, you know, I was sold as a young nigga. I was like, okay, that's what it is. And, you know, I just been doing this shit, and I always try to give my all and always try to do something meaningful. Whenever I do what I do, I don't just like to jump out there and just be talking a bunch of nonsense and bullshit that don't help anybody out or don't achieve anything besides a bunch of death and destruction. Because trust me, I didn't offer enough death and destruction in my life. So I'm on a point where I'm really trying to build and offer somebody some positivity and some light and a way out of a fucked up situation that they may be going through.
Definitely, man. And look, of course, we got to give a shout out to H-Town, you know, North Side, South Side, Sunnyside, South Acres. Shout out to the 832, 281, the 713. You know, all y'all.
Yeah, I see you know it, Lasati.
Yeah, man. Look, you come from a distinguished history, you know, in terms of the Lone Star State, man. Of course, shout out to Jay Prince, you know, the Ghetto Boys. I mean, we got to give love to Chingo Bling, Lil Kiki. You know, little Slim Thug. I mean UGK.
Yeah,
we got
a rich history, and we also got a present day, man. It's going on. I know. I don't just know how far a lot of the artists, underground artists in the city have reached, but like the underground is bubbling real hard out here, man. You got a whole bunch of cats, females and dudes, that's putting in a bunch of work. And it's a bunch of good music. It's so much music that sometimes a lot of shit get lost in the shuffle because it's, you know, everybody got something to offer, but then you only got so much time in a day to you know, soak up as much as you can. But you got a bunch of cats out here that's working, man, you know. Shout out to my nigga Beat King, my nigga Wi-Fi, my nigga Young Martez, my nigga Underboss Flawless. Oh, man, I can just go on 790 MG to my block, man. They working. You got a bunch of people out here working, man. And, you know, if you just really want to tap in to what's going on in the city, man, it's a bunch of people out here that's doing shit and making good music. They just not just throwing shit out there but making real good music, like quality music.
Definitely, man. And look, we definitely got a head host in the building, King Eric. He's back in the queue. What it do, King?
Yeah, I'm back in the building right now. How y'all doing, y'all?
What it do, man? What it do? Look, we just...
I'm multitasking right now, man. I'm hosting the dope show, and I'm trying to move this wash machine out of my laundry room, but... We got a job to do, darn it.
God, yeah. That's a hell of a
multitasking. Right,
yeah.
Now.
Yeah.
Let me get sit down and get that back brace on for a bit and do some commentary. Then I get back at it. What's going on, y'all?
Yeah, chilling. What's up with it?
Yeah, man. Go ahead, King.
Yeah, I'm happy and excited, man. Another Friday night, episode 352 underway. We got SmackWater 790 spitting that revolutionary fire that to make your skin crawl and a coward niggas back to shape.
Yeah, man, it's that shit, man. It's, you know, it's gonna make a motherfucker stand up or lay down. That's the only two options, man. We talking that shit that's going on right now today. You know, that's with society, with our people, with politics, with economics, you know, with the younger generation. You know, we address a whole bunch of different subjects, like shit that motherfuckers be wanting to say but afraid to say, some shit motherfuckers say behind closed doors, and you know, but the album is like a 2020 chronic. We had a write-up in a magazine, and somebody wrote up and said, man, this album is like a mixture of Marvin Gaye, What's Going On, and N.W.A. Straight Outta Compton. And the first time I heard it, I was like, it took me back a little bit. I was like, huh? And then when I actually thought about it, I was like, damn, we do got the social commentary of Marvin and the don't-give-a-fuck attitude of N.W.A. about it. So they kind of nailed it. That's what they got from it. So you got to respect people's perspective and shit, so... But yeah, man, we here for a purpose, you know. Try to get a people something to see them, to help see them through this madness that's going on in today's society.
Definitely. And one thing about it, SmackWater, is, you know, when you make that, when that publication made that comparison in terms of an amalgam of what it was with Marvin Gaye's What's Going On and N.W.A., you know, Straight Outta Compton, two of the most elite and classic and revered albums, respectfully, in their respective genres, of course, hip-hop and R&B. One thing about it is that when you look at the voices, of course, rest in peace, Marvin, who was just an unbelievable singer as well as such a soulful conscience for the soul of the black community. And, of course, N.W.A., you know, shout out Easy, rest in peace. And, of course, Dre, Cube, Yella, Ren, you know, who really tackled the establishment in a fashion that was very aggressive and in your face. There was an extension of what was going on in the 80s, of course, with Public Enemy, KRS-One, you know, X-Clan, you know, the whole, you know, revolutionary, you know, African-American, you know, the Black Power movement.
Yeah.
So this is how praise that you guys have received in terms of what this, you know, what your present opus has represented. Hip-hop has always been a voice for the black and brown community since its inception. You know, some historians would even take it back to James Brown in terms of him laying down the fundamental rhythms of the blueprints and the ad-libs, you know, for what would eventually morph into hip-hop. Of course, shout out to Gil Scott-Heron, rest in peace, and the Last Poets, who would, you know, would really bring the spoken word into the game. Of course, shout out DJ Kool Herc, August 16th, you know, 1976, I believe, when hip-hop was, you know, born in terms of the Bronx, 1520 Sedgwick Avenue, you know, in terms
The phrase wasn't coined yet, but the actual movement began.
Right, because the phrase was actually coined, and we just got to keep the history separate in terms of the personal issues, you know, Afrika Bambaataa. You know, who gave it its name? You know,
he coined it. Boy, you're tough.
Always,
you're a hip hop historian like me. I like that.
That's why we call T Max with the facts.
Yeah, he definitely factual. He's a fax machine over there.
That's why we put him on. I like he be putting me on the things I didn't know. So you need that sometimes.
Yeah. You got to know that history, and you got to know them facts, man. Because I know a lot of people in today's society really don't give a damn about the history and the facts of it. But it's to somebody of my degree and caliber, it's refreshing, and I love to hear it. But I know like these younger generations, they could give a fuck about it, to tell others the God truth, you know. Because the system done a good job of making sure that we stay divided. They keep older heads saying the youngsters is on some dumb, stupid shit, and they keep the youngsters saying the older heads is hating on them. So, you know, that's a great divide, and it's a master strategy from the system and the industries on their behalf, because they want to exploit the shit out of these young, naive kids, and you know, they don't know no better. You take a starving kid out of the hood, and you give him a little money, a little jewelry, you give him a car, give him a gun so he could point it at the camera in his video and talk about how he gonna shoot the next nigga, and, you know, give him a couple of bitches to shake their ass, and he cool. And he's unaware of the fact that he's being fucked over the whole while and being used up, and they siphoning him for everything he got. And he hot today, and next year, ain't nobody even gonna give a fuck about him. But you know, you can't tell him that. And as long as they keep us separated, the older, we can't give them that knowledge. They don't even want to hear it. They gonna shun it. They gonna reject it because, nigga, you hating. Nah, I'm trying to give you something, my nigga. I'm trying to be, they giving you a motherfucking piece of bread and a piece of bologna and telling you it's a meal when I'm actually trying to give you, like, a Sunday dinner. But you don't want that because, you know, they trained us to think and feel a certain type of way about each other and create all these different isms and live by them, and it really hurts us as a society, as a community as well.
You know, one thing about it, Smack, is when we, you know, me and King, we, you know, of course, our co-hosts, you know, as well, we talk on and off the air about this. Because what you said resonates so true, because we're looking at where the game was. You know, shout out to Uncle Richie Rich in the Bay Area, you know, out in Oakland. Because he talked about, you know, we've had him on a couple of times. He talked about how, back in the day out in the Bay, you know, you weren't even getting in the booth, let alone releasing anything until, like, you know, heads on the street knew you were really ready in terms of you were going to represent right. From where we've always seen, and hip-hop has always been a very candid and at times aggressive communication of the culture, because it is part of the culture in terms of the music, you know, of course, of the five elements, you know, breaking,
yeah,
you know, of course, DJing,
graffiti.
You know,
yeah,
graffiti,
DJing.
Yeah,
MCing,
you know, so,
yeah,
MCing, yeah, so
the five
it falls under MCing, yeah,
yeah, beatboxing,
yeah, doing the knowledge,
yeah.
So when we look at it, of where it was, because it isn't always gonna, it hasn't always been pretty, and it hasn't always been politically correct. But what we've kind of seen, and you know, King and myself are older, so we were babies. You know, hip hop is our mother, you know, and our father that taught us about the ways. And what we've seen now, like you said, is a lot of these young kids coming into the game. It's like a lot of them really don't understand the context in which the music, and it's, I guess, all arbitrary in terms of how people want to express themselves, because no two people are alike. But I guess you see a deliberately, you know, by the powers that be, a dumbing down of the music. You know, when we see a lot of these artists coming in, and this is not to say that a lot of the new artists who are young are trash, because a lot of these young artists are really great. shout out to Dave East. You know, shout out to Roddy Rich out in LA doing the thing.
Yeah, Roddy Rich. Vince Staples. Yeah.
Yeah, Vince Staples, of course.
Yeah.
You know, but what do we see where a lot of these young artists coming in, you know, like Young Thug, you know, 6ix9ine, you know, who have a very, very polarizing audience in terms of their style of music, in terms of where theatrics seem to extend more than the actual music itself.
Yeah, but gimmicks only get you so far, and it's a hard lesson learned, like a motherfucker.
Mm-hmm.
Like, that shit only gonna carry over so far, because your audience is gonna grow, you know what I'm saying? And
right,
they're gonna outgrow the gimmicks. You know what I'm saying? You, that shit is appealing to, you know, a younger and like you say, a dumbed down society. But at some point, when responsibility and life kick in, you know, that shit that ain't gonna even make sense to you no more. You know what I'm saying? Shit that appealed to me when I was a teenager, I might still listen to it, but it don't appeal to me in the same way. Like I can't see myself going out there and just taking part of some youthful, young, ignorant, naive shit. You know what I'm saying? Basically.
Right.
You know, but Tekashi, fuck that bitch ass nigga, but not to knock Slim Thug, you know, but nah, fuck Tekashi, cake ass nigga. That nigga out, man. You just had some real live niggas who represent the culture, you know, that, you know, they it's fucked up that their life was taken away from them. But at the same time, you know, they stood on principle on what they believed in. And for here you go, this cake ass nigga Tekashi 6ix9ine, you know, just come and just, you know, and motherfuckers try to justify the shit. You know, I ain't no way you could justify that shit there. If you say you this and this is what you represent, hey man, take it all the way to the wall. Balls to the wall, bitch ass nigga. Don't crawfish. You know what I'm saying? When it get heated, don't crawfish. If this what you about, be about that, my nigga. Take ass nigga, man. They and this nigga here, you know, it is what it is, man. I ain't even finna just go into detail about all that.
Understood.
With that cake ass nigga. Yeah.
But you know what I'm saying?
I'm a nigga of integrity, my nigga.
But you know what? And it's funny you build on that, because when I was looking at the verses last night with Jeezy and Gucci Mane, right? You know, when I look at battles like that, I look at things like that, I try to decipher different layers behind it. Like, I seen how when he started dissing Jeezy's partner and, you know, mocking him and everything, I seen that a lot of the young bulls, they was, like, getting excited with that, and they was, like, egging him on.
Yeah,
you know, their ego is something. And Jeezy went ahead and told him, look, man, we grown. We 40 years old now. We trying to put this behind us and trying to set a good example, because a lot of them got that from us.
Yeah.
So you start seeing that.
Yeah, Jeezy showed a whole lot of restraint and, you know, tried to take the high road. He got his shots in here and now. They were a little more subtle and subliminal than covert, and Gucci was just a savage about it, you know, and I could dig it. Gucci appealing to the young bucks, and you know, and they, you know, I seen one dude on Instagram and he was like, I feel like Gucci won, even though Jeezy might got the better songs, but I feel like Gucci won because he was more ignorant. And I was like, God damn. What the fuck did this nigga just say? And he like, and you know, I'm here for all the ignorant shit. I was like, and I really had to sit back and process that shit. I had to process it for a little bit, and then it hit me. I was like, niggas don't be completing the entire statement. What is the main problem? Like if niggas completed the entire statement, then it would add a whole lot more context to it. Like niggas always say, I'm about that action, or I'm here for the ignorant shit. Complete the statement. I'm about that action and I'm here for the ignorant shit when it's concerning another black motherfucker. But you ain't about that action and you ain't here for the ignorant shit when it's concerning the white folks and them police, when it got to do with the white folks shit. You ain't about that action then. You ain't about that ignorant shit then. Man, you niggas crazy.
You know.
Yeah, niggas crazy for wanting to stand up for something right. Man, I ain't got time to be dealing with all that whole ass shit. But you got time when it's anything destroying and tearing down the next black man or the black community.
And one thing about it, Smack. Oh, go ahead, please.
Go ahead.
Yeah, you know, but one thing about it, Smack, of course, you know, shout out to Jeezy, CTE, you know, Boo Rossini, you know, Snoop 11, DJ Ace, you know, the whole crew, those are my guys. You know, Sheldon G, you know, those are my guys. And, you know, Jeezy, good friend of mine, is to watch him last night, knowing the history of what was between those guys. You know, me and King got a joke about Gucci in terms of, you know, the 2009 animal Gucci, you know, savage Gucci, fat Gucci,
yeah,
kick a bitch out the car Gucci.
Yeah, that nigga that. Yeah, that nigga
that.
You
know, so.
Yeah, that nigga
that. Gucci kind of went back to that for a second last night. For the culture of it, you know, as a, knowing those guys, knowing Jeezy, you know, and knowing that whole situation, and, you know, I'm going to tread lightly when I say this, you know, that situation about how people are trying to say about how Jeezy sent somebody to go out and kill Gucci. That is not true. You need to do your research behind the whole story. That is not what happened. That is not how that, now, it was an unfortunate circumstance to transpire, but no, Jeezy did not put any money on Gucci's head. That is not what went down that led to Pookie Lowe getting killed.
In that song, Jeezy did say he got 10,000 for the nigga chain. He didn't put money on his head like kill that nigga, but he put a bounty on the chain. So, but that could be, you know, it perceived any way. But when you talking the street niggas and young niggas that's doped up, drugged up, and you know. So it is what it is. I'm not taking one side or the other, but
understood.
Those were his
right,
words.
But you're
you know
right.
what I'm saying?
Well, that's why.
And it's kind of like going back to the top.
Yeah,
it's kind of like going back to what Smack was saying about gimmicks, right? Now, we know musically, Jeezy has the most superior catalog. I mean, when it comes to production value and ad-libs and what he brought to the dance, his catalog is more superior than Gucci in that sense. So sometimes, you know, I think what he did was he went back to the gimmicks because, you know, that what gets the crowd rowdied up a little bit. That's why you see what they're basically following his imprint. They see what Gucci did, well, you know, dissing a dead man. Now you see these young bulls doing the same thing. You know, they dissing people that get killed.
That's real big with these youngsters. Nah, they, you know, they jump on social media after some they op get popped, and you know they act a fool about the nigga getting killed and all that shit. There, you know, it ain't no respect for the dead no more, especially when you're considered opposition and the enemy. Like, nigga, fuck, it's always been that, but, you know, nah, it's over the top.
Man.
Yeah. Man, them niggas going ahead, they doing full videos the day after he get killed. They not even waiting a week no more. They doing it the 3 hours.
Yeah, as soon as the news hit social media, it go crazy. It go crazy from point said go. So, you know, it's a new era. And, you know,
it's
the shit ain't going to get no better.
Yeah, it is.
The shit ain't going to get no better. And you just got to be realistic about it. Like, this shit only going to get worse. This shit ain't going to get no better. You can't put that motherfucking genie back in the bottle. This motherfucker is out.
You're right.
This
genie
is out the bottle, and it's not going back in.
You know, and you're right on that perspective, because when you look at how situations get started, you know, in terms of situations that go, you know, I think if, you know, back in the day, if those guys could have found a common ground, you know, because it is true what you said. It's all about the words and semantics in terms of what you said about, now, Jeezy did put money on the man's chain, but he did not put it necessarily on his life. But that's where the whole situation turns into, because what happens, like I said, with the circumstances, you know, we have obviously, you know, the incident. But to basically kind of play that out there, when Jeezy, and shout out to Jeezy on how he basically, like King said, you know, we're here to basically do this for the culture. You know, we're doing this for King Von. You know, we're doing this for a lot of other rappers who have lost their lives behind the foolishness, and we're not here to really, really celebrate it. And Gucci kind of understood that, I think, when Jeezy said it. Because one thing about it, when we look at all the recent situations, we look at what happened with King Von, we look at what happened with FBG Duck, you know, we look at Boosie getting shot, you know, we look at Benny the Butcher getting shot. Wanted to build on what you said too earlier, Mac, about what you said about when everybody said about that actually, about that ignorance. Those are very ambiguous terms that a lot of niggas use in the street, where they really want to pump themselves up with that adrenaline, like they're really, really ready to sweat it out.
Yeah, niggas be got to sell they self something sometimes too in order just to do shit. I'm going to hit that nigga in his mouth when I see him. And you say that in front of 6-7 niggas, now you got to hit that nigga in the mouth when you see him. Because now them 6'7" niggas, look, that go that nigga right there. You know.
Yeah.
Just to see if you gonna hit that nigga in the mob. Yeah. And if you don't hit that nigga in the mob wall, bitch ass nigga, you scared of that nigga. That nigga would have got on your whole ass, cake ass nigga, whooped it. You know, so it's a perpetual, it's a vicious cycle that we stuck in, like, psychologically and spiritually and emotionally. Like, we got a real arrested development when it comes to our thought process in the hood. You know what I'm saying? Like, it's really fucked up. It really is, man. It's fucked up. I'm a victim of it. I got my ways. I'm not above it, and I'm not better than anybody. It's just that I recognize it, you know, and because I put myself on Front Street. I done some dumb shit, a lot of dumb shit in my life, and possibly might do some more, you know.
Definitely.
Somebody might view some shit.
You know,
yeah, somebody might view me doing some dumb shit. Something I done today is some dumb shit. But, you know, you never know. It's all about perspective.
But you know what I think a problem is too, guys, is this. I think another thing is, and I noticed this within hip-hop culture, we don't allow each other to grow. And I ain't saying just hip-hop, but also in the community, period.
That's a profound-ass statement, my nigga. That shit that got so many layers and undertones, that's a profound statement. We refuse to allow each other to grow, my nigga. You can't grow. You got to stay the same nigga that you always was. That's what motherfuckers expect of you. They expect you to be the same nigga. You know what I'm saying? Jay-Z said it better. Nigga, you think I made all this money so I could stay the same, my nigga? Like, you think I'm doing all this to be the same nigga I was 10 years ago? I can't be the same nigga I was 10 years ago because I can't gain more success but still be the same nigga around you niggas because the success won't last. You niggas ain't going to allow the success to last because y'all going to be looking to tear my head out. That's why you want a nigga to stay the same so you can rob the shit out of a nigga.
You know, one thing about it is evolution is essential. You know, when Snow
and
was
inevitable.
Talking about, you know, and inevitable, yes, because when Snow... You know, because what you said, Smack, about how, you know, Jeezy was jabbing Gooch last night, because I was just laughing at some of the shit Snow was saying because it was so true. When Gooch was saying, this is a $10,000 outfit, and Jeezy countered it with, yeah, but I own half of Atlanta.
Yeah. Jeezy was just a little more strategic and a little more. I don't want to say bougie or elegant, but his jabs were a little more like you got Mike Tyson just
surgical.
Come out swinging, and then you got Ali coming out on some calculated shit, and Jeezy was a little more calculated. Goo-Wop just came out swinging.
He learned that from Jay. You know where because Jay, he's the master of them slick remarks and them slick jabs and stuff like that.
Yeah.
You know, one thing about it when you're in the business of the music, you know, it's always about, you know, we're seeing a level of, you know, entrepreneurship in hip hop more than we have ever seen. You know, shout out to Jay becoming a billionaire.
Man.
You know, shout out to Dr. Dre becoming a billionaire. Shout out to Snow with his Worth for Conversation podcast. You know, being a real estate mogul, doing what he's doing. You know, shout out to, you know, Griselda, you know, with their clothing line and their skill as well as making music.
Shout out everybody, you'll be shouting out all night because never have we seen so many black people take their own destiny in their hand and guide their own life like.
Yeah.
In this industry. Yeah, never. Shout out to King James, nigga, LeBron James. You got a lot of motherfuckers who hate LeBron, but, you know, they hate LeBron. They like, oh, he did. But I'm going to tell you what I see when I look at LeBron. I see the very first motherfucking athlete that totally made the whole league bent to his will. Not even Jordan. Jordan was even expendable if he got out of line. Never have we seen an athlete like LeBron James. Fuck that he put together super team. You should commend that. That here go a black man that was able to say, nigga, this is what we going to do on this team right here. And the owner and everybody, like, hey, the whole league. You've never seen that. You got black, and now you got Kevin Durant. What he do? Man, I'm going over here to Golden State. Left Golden State, I'm going to Brook. Motherfucker saying, what it, we about to lose James Harden because he just turned down $50 million to play for us. But at the same time, I commend him for taking his own destiny in his own fucking hands. Because for so long, our destiny has been controlled by the system and by the elite and by other motherfuckers. So any black man who could hold his nuts and say, this what I'm doing, bitch-ass nigga, and make the system bend to their will, man, you got to respect that. Because never have we been able to call a shot and control anything, especially being a part of the system and inside of the system. We've always been trapped. We've always been considered property. You might be property, but never have a slave ever said, nigga, I'm finna go work over here on Master Johnson for him. Fuck Master Franklin.
You know, and that's a very important element in terms of self-enterprise and moving forward, because at the end of the day, you know, for whatever business endeavor you have, Smack, it's all about what you feel is the best opportunity. LeBron, I can't give enough love, enough respect, enough shout-outs to LeBron, you know, for not only being on the front lines of social change and speaking out on things, but just also in terms of his camp, you know, I mean, you know, just bringing all them dudes along with him, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
It's like, you know what I'm saying? Maverick Carter.
It's day one. Everybody eat.
Yeah.
Everybody get to
all
a plate.
Dudes.
Everybody, I turn all y'all into moguls and millionaires and, you know, hey, man, you know, all of that shit there, man, that means something. That should mean something to every black man walking the planet, unless you just a fucking idiot. You know what I'm saying? Basically, flat out, just an idiot, man. That should mean something to you. You should hold that close to the vest, man, and be like, wow, man, this is a hell of an example that he set. Let you know, man, you ain't just got to settle for what a motherfucker say your life got to be or who you got to be. You could decide who the fuck you want to be for your own motherfucking self. Because, shit, how many motherfuckers that have been in sports come in and they say, clear your lockout, nigga. You playing in Alaska tomorrow. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. And I think a lot of
And the cold part is LeBron put on, and the, you know, and what made me really look at LeBron in a different light is, he put on everybody from his hood and put them in power positions to control his career.
Yeah. And, you know, and that's a good thing to be able to see, because in our community and in our way of thinking, we believe that we can't trust the next black man. You know what I'm saying? That, you know, ain't no way I'm going to put another nigga over my career, over my money, over the decision making. You know what I'm saying? So to turn that over to another brother, another black man, even, but, you know, y'all got history. You know, y'all been around each other since ninth grade. But, nigga, I got niggas I've been knowing since I was a baby. Nigga, I wouldn't trust them niggas. Shit, with $5 laying on the table. You know what I'm saying? So to be able, just LeBron and the brothers that's around him, you gotta big up them for being some stand up stiff niggas. You know, that's you know, it's hard to find that, man. It really is. No matter how long you've known somebody or how you feel about them, because you know, shit, I done been burnt by my own fucking blood, kinfolk. So, you know.
Yeah, and, you know, one thing about it, man, is that I think as black people, you know, we have to understand the power of unity in our community. But when you look at also, too, there is such a divide between the have and the have-nots. It's a very pronounced one, whether riches, whether academics, whether opportunities, which, you know, when you're already looking at us as people of color in this country who already are disenfranchised by our skin color alone, you know, we have added fights to fight. And I will not let anyone ever, you know, not some of these new Negroes out here who like to say, you know, that racism, you know, it's a thing of the past. You know,
there's a few out here that you know, you can't tell Candace Owen these white folks don't love the fuck out of us.
Look, I remember
racism is a thing in the past.
Yeah, you know, and that's a very dangerous element that I think a lot of black people fall into when they think about we've moved, you know, and I can only speak on this because this was in an online GQ article that Cam Newton spoke about, you know, when he was talking, when they asked him about what do they think about, just blacks, you know, in American society, racism. And he said, you know, I just feel like, you know, we've moved past it. You know, why are we still talking about it? And I'm like,
that runs me high. And Cam was one of my favorite athletes. I remember when he said that, man, I was heartbroken, man. I like, you niggas, man. You niggas, all you got to do is give a nigga a little bit of money. Let them stay next to them white folks. Let them fuck a couple white bitches. And, nigga, we didn't move past racism. Nigga, don't you know I'm putting dick on 4-5 white bitches at a time, bitch ass nigga? I don't give a goddamn about no racism. That bitch ain't moved past racism. She passed the black and white, but she damn sure ain't passed the green, bitch ass nigga. If the same bitch ass nigga who said it, if you didn't have no money, your bitch ass would be blacker than a motherfucker, and they'd be ready to call them laws on your bitch ass if you even looked their direction. And these niggas got the game fucked up, man. All you gotta do is give a nigga a little bit of money, man. Niggas gonna, you know, half the niggas out here wanna sell dope and kill each other, and the other half gonna sell us out. You know what I'm saying? You got a handful of motherfuckers that's going to stay stiff. And the niggas that's going to stay stiff and go ride for the cause, it ain't going to be enough of them. And the rest of the niggas going to call you crazy for being out there trying to free they dumb, stupid black ass. But you can't free a motherfucker who don't even know they're a slave.
And that's real, Snap, because when you're dealing with the one thing about it in America, the black man and the black woman we've always had to fight our whole life, from slavery to Jim Crow to post-Jim Crow, then civil rights, you know. I mean, you know,
nigga, still
even
a slave. You still a slave. You, me, we still slaves. You don't think you property of America? Get up and leave this motherfucker without a passport if you think you free.
True that.
If you think you free, leave this bitch without a passport then, cake-ass nigga. I dare you. You belong to America, my nigga, when you born. You property of America. You got a birth certificate and a certificate of birth. One of them they get to your parents and one of them the government keep. You ain't free. Ain't none of us free. Black, white, Mexican, none of us free.
Yeah.
No matter if you're a poor. Huh?
Go ahead. No. Go ahead.
Yeah, if you're a poor, uneducated, middle class, you know, only the most elite motherfuckers is moving around how they want to move around. But the rest of us, man, we are property. Outside of America, if you from in Mexico, if you from Salvador, you property of them people. Brazil, you property. try to leave that motherfucker without a passport. You might can sneak off in some of them little third world countries where it's a little more lax. But you definitely in America, they ain't, man, you property, man. You property of America. Don't you get it fucked up.
And one thing about being in America is, in terms of understanding the history from all sides, you know, because what you said about, you know, white people too, you know, because a lot of white people have bought in to, not all white people, but of course a lot, you know, have bought into, you know, the whole thing because of, you know, their color, that they have the meritocracy of supremacy, you know. But the fact is, a lot of times it just simply comes down to class. Like you said, it's not the elite, you know, the haves and the have-nots, which are really, color eventually comes into it. But when you have money, it does give you a certain level of comfort and privilege. You know, I will never forget, you know, and he's from your state, the late President Lyndon B. Johnson. He said, if you can convince the lowest white man that he's better than the average colored man, you can empty out his pockets. Hell, give him someone to look down on and he'll empty out his pockets for you.
Yeah.
You know?
Shit. You know they... Nigga, they spray painted nigga on LeBron James' gate. The poet's white boy still think he's better than the best of us. Don't matter how good you is, how much money you got, how accomplished you is, you still a nigga. Ain't that something? A motherfucker like
and
LeBron James, like Beyonce, Jay-Z, nigga, you still a nigga. I'm still better. White boy living in a trailer in Kentucky. You can't tell him he ain't better than Jay-Z, nigga. Fuck that nigga.
Hey.
How much money you got?
And you know, Snap, the most insidious part about racism in this country, because on Off the Cuff, we're not afraid to go there. We always speak on these things in the most intelligent and factual way that we know how. But one thing about racism that is so insidious, that is so much of a disease, is that those who practice it will sacrifice their own best self-interest in the name of hate. And even if they get burned up in the process, their thing is, as long as the people we don't like don't have anything, we're okay, even if it brings about our own destruction as well. i.e. this last administration, this outgoing administration of the guy who got elected. Everybody knew he was the wrong guy for the job, but you had a lot of people. But when they asked a lot of people, you know, why did, you know, what is it about, you know Donald Trump that, you know, you like about him? They're like, well, you know, he doesn't speak like a politician. You know, he speaks like me. You know, he says what's on his mind. So when I understand that, you know, and I like to think of myself, King, we're both fairly educated people. When we read the subliminals behind that, we look at the sentiments, because a lot of people like to say that racism is dead. You know, we move past it as a society. No. 45 getting elected was the referendum of how racism is still alive and well in this country. It's in the sordid underbelly of, when you look at how slaves were brought to this land, forcefully ripped from Mother Africa, and we were brought here against our will, you know, that has always been ingrained. But when I hear people talk about, well, he speaks what's on his mind, that says to me at times, you know, that tells me, you know what, for some of y'all, that means that basically he's echoing the sentiments that y'all just won't say publicly, but he will. He endorses the very thing, the very evil that is in this country that you all will try to ignore, you know, and or say doesn't exist. But, you know, you're okay voting for a guy that says, you know, that calls, you know, basically paints all Mexicans as rapists and murderers, you know, that, you know, any type of protesting against him when he wants to talk about Antifa being a terrorist group, when Antifa is anti-fascism, Antifa is against people like him. But anything that opposes who he what he represents in terms of is an affront to his stances. Oh, they're bad people. You know, these are people who are not American. You know, when he tells, you know, when he said a son of a bitch who refuses to stand for the flag when he was talking about Kaepernick, I'm like, what type of individual in leadership would even address a person like that? I mean, the stupidity.
Well, you know, he empowers. He empowered a certain way of thinking.
Right.
That
right,
that like
right.
The thinking is gonna always exist.
Right.
You know, and the same. Don't get me wrong. Joe Biden ain't no goddamn different. Yeah. Joe Biden ain't no different. You know what I'm saying? Joe Biden and Donald Trump is the same nigga. Both of them belong to the same bird. One on the right, one is the right wing, one is the left wing. But you asking, you fighting over the bird, though. It's the same mm-hmm. goddamn bird. Joe Biden is racist. He just covert. He just not in your face. Only difference between Joe Biden and Donald Trump is Joe Biden wear his hood down and Donald Trump wear his hood up. That's the difference between. And I know a lot of black people don't want to hear that and don't want to understand it. A lot of black people, when it comes to shit like that, they just as rejective about that as white folks is about religion. I mean, white folks is about racism. How white folks don't see racism, a lot of black folks can't see that. That nigga the same, nigga. Donald Trump, fuck you raw. He take it. Donald Trump gonna take it. And Joe Biden gonna kiss you, and you know, but he still gonna stick it in where you don't want it stuck in at. But he just gonna kiss you and tell you it's all right. Might use a little lube. Same nigga, my nigga. They the exact same nigga.
Now, would you say this is a referendum on politics? Would you say this is basically a referendum on politics across the board in this country, where some people feel like on both sides, you know, Democratic and Republican, that there's been enough of a two-party system where we need a third party that some people feel that really represents people from all sides as opposed to two?
I was just thinking about that yesterday, but, you know, it'll be hard as fuck for a third party to break through. It'll be hard because everybody is so steeped in tradition and in belief, and they sold this liberal and conservative idea, Democrat and Republican. I really hate those fucking titles, because especially when I see like Candace Owens, that fucking bitch right there. She just a stupid bitch at times, man. It runs me hot how she try to say about conservative. She a conservative. Fucking bitch. Slave owners was conservative at one time. It's these liberals. It was the liberals that freed the slave fucking bitch. She was talking about liberal Hollywood because she had a post about it. And I agree with what she said about the feminization of men and these bitch ass niggas wearing dresses on this old gay ass shit. You got the right. I'm not bashing gays. You got the right to be gay. You got the right to do what you want to do, be who you want to be. You deserve the same rights, freedoms, and happiness that anybody else enjoys in this country. I'm not saying that you don't deserve none of that and you can't be who you want to be. But I'm just saying,
right,
motherfuckers love to say normalize. Why you got to use the word normalize? Because the shit is abnormal. That's why you say normalize, because it's not normal. Because if it was normal, we wouldn't even be having a conversation about it. It wouldn't be a problem with it if it's normal, but it not being normal is the fucking problem. You trying to make something normal that's not normal. It was a point of time homosexuality wasn't normal, but through the fixation and through the propagation of it and the steady push of it, more and more people have become more accepting to it, to where it's like, okay, well, it's the new normal. Motherfuckers walking around with masks, everybody in society walking around with a fucking mask on, wasn't normal. But now it's the new normal.
Now, in terms of when we look at the effeminization to where, you know, there has because this has definitely been prevalent. This has been talked about for a few years now in hip hop in terms of where this has all come in. Where do you think it started changing in terms of hip hop from where, you know, there was a certain look that was really, you know, considered more of a standard masculinity as opposed to where now we're looking at the just styles that are more equated to feminine fashions that we see some, you know, male rappers and entertainers wearing?
Evolution happens in real time. Like, motherfuckers be like, evolution isn't real. Every day, evolution happens, you know, and it happens in real time. And sometimes it's subtle. So it's hard to pinpoint an exact moment because it was a step-by-step process of getting to that point. Oh, you want me to prove to you that evolution is real? I'm going to show you. And this is as simple as I can put it. And if you try to dispute this, I don't know what's wrong with you. I'm going to show you evolution is real. 20 years ago, if a motherfucker walked up to you and said, LOL, what the fuck would you have said and thought?
What does that mean?
But now somebody say LOL is clear and understood. We've actually changed the way we think. Like, a motherfucker can put up a conversation in all letters and you can read it. That one that you damn near never. I seen somebody put up a post yesterday say every black person know what this mean. SYB something, but the quote was, sit your bitch ass down before I beat your motherfucking ass. Every black person know what this mean because your mama done said this to you before. And it just had all the letters there. First time I had ever seen it, and as soon as I looked at it, I knew exactly what the fuck it was. Sit your bitch ass down before I beat your motherfucking ass.
You know, and
20
it's
years
funny,
ago,
Matt,
my brain wouldn't have, huh?
And it's funny you say that, Matt, because when you look at it in terms of the acronym of, you know, because social media has really become an outlet for a lot of expression. On one hand of it, I find it humorous. I even find it creatively innovative how we've been able to break down those phrases that we all knew in the hood. And it's like, we know, it's like, you know, that's like, you know, that's like just an automatic black card when you know what that means because you've heard it say it, just broken it down into letters, you know.
But to even think that a motherfucker could put them letters there and you could comprehend them letters without never even seeing them before, because we have evolved to the point to where we know those letters mean something, and your brain automatic something clicks in your brain where it puts it together as soon as I seen it, I knew what the fuck it meant.
Right.
As soon as I looked at it, I say, sit your bitch ass down before I beat your motherfucking ass. And I had to stop and think, like, damn. Like, that's
evolution.
How did you
figure that out? Yeah, you're like, how did I know that?
Yeah, it's evolution, because through seeing shit like LOL or LMAO, RL, ROLFAO, or whatever, rolling on the floor, laughing my fucking ass off. You see all these here different things so much, OMW. On my way. You know what I'm saying? You see all this shit so much that you the brain is a mysterious thing, but that's a part of evolution. Like, we are evolving to where we can actually, you know, break down letters that don't even say anything, but they say something. But we have evolved into that point. Because if somebody would have posted or would have wrote that shit down 20 years ago, we would have been looking at it like, man, what the fuck is that?
How do you look at social media now in terms of being an outlet for expression in terms of how things are? Because back in the day, when we look at music and, you know, of course, you know, I mean, back in the day, I mean, 20 years ago, I mean, we're thinking like the days of Black Planet, you know, this is back to like 99 2000, my would have come to
when it first came about.
Yeah, and we were you figure my face wouldn't come till maybe around what, 4 or 5 years later. Facebook would come in 2004, you know, but Facebook was still limited primarily to college networks. It wasn't really public. So we're seeing now the social media in terms of, you know, how people are able to get, you know, there through Twitter, Facebook, IG, how they're able to express themselves, you know, just like, you know, you and your crew, how you're able to express your music, you know, and really give people a message that back in the day, it would have been harder because, dog, we, you know, especially with, you know, what's kind of studying things back in the day of how music was, I mean, just to get into a studio back in the day, I mean, you had to really kind of have a connection.
Yeah.
I mean,
not everybody walking around with a studio in their fucking hand.
Yeah, and they with their phone. You know what I mean? And a makeshift, you know, camera right there to shoot a video.
Yeah, everything,
I mean, now,
man. Everything. Yeah.
You know, and
you
it's
know,
funny, Smack. Oh, go ahead.
I view everything has a good and bad side, but what I love most about the internet is that it's the great equalizer, because for the longest, like, the industry was controlled and manipulated by a small few, and so many people, talented people, you know, careers died and didn't even get a chance because of the few that controlled the industry. Like a motherfucker back in the day before the internet, a walk in an office and tell, and here go a motherfucker who lives in a bubble, you know, telling somebody, oh, that ain't gonna sell. You know, how the fuck do you know? Like, I look at a bunch of these niggas, I wouldn't sign a lot of niggas, you know, but I still enjoy the fact to see that they succeed with whatever little gimmick or look or whatever the fuck they use, because I was like, nigga, ain't no way, like, a lot of these niggas is some funny looking niggas. They ain't no way you could have walked them niggas into Russell Simmons' office and Russell Simmons would have signed them. You know what
That's
I'm saying?
True.
He would be like, who the fuck is gonna buy that? But it's an audience for everything and everybody, but since you had just a few controlling it, they wanted to control what it looked like and what it sounded like and what it felt like, what it smelled like, what it tasted like. But now it's eclectic. It's a plethora. It's something for everybody. Because motherfuckers forgot about motherfuckers over here. I remember when I was in high school and I've seen the first, that's when that goth shit first hit. When I was like in the ninth grade, I seen my first goth white person.
You talking about
like Marilyn Black
Manson? Like,
huh? Yeah, but this was
like
even before Marilyn Manson. This was way before Marilyn Manson. This, they was walking around in all black, real pale and shit. And I was like, damn, these white folks think they vampires. You know what I'm saying? But that was goth, and you know, but it was motherfuckers. They was considered like a subgenre. They was like outlaws. They was outliers. They didn't nobody give a fuck about catering to them and they likes and they wants and they needs and they desires. Fuck them.
Mm-hmm.
But it was a bunch of them out there. And then you had a bunch of people who wished they could express themselves, but in a different way. But since, you know, the bell curve of society was like, oh, that's not normal. So motherfuckers, they was like, well, I want to fit in over here, so I won't do that. And motherfuckers wasn't catering to certain motherfuckers. That's how hip hop came about. Wasn't nobody catering to motherfuckers in our area. Didn't nobody give a fuck about how you felt or your needs, your desires. So here come Kool Herc and the rest of these cats, and they gave a fuck about, because they was one of us. And that's how hip hop came to be, because some people needed a voice that represented them. The unforgotten, the unheard, the voiceless, the unpowerful, you know?
And that comes full circle to where your movement is, Smack, because your music is very politically charged and very socially conscious. In terms of we early in the show we spoke on who inspired you, but what really gave you that in terms of for your presence in the game, what really inspired you in terms of being very politically, you know, charged in terms of your expression with it? Was it something that was always in you?
With this album, it was
a moment.
It really wasn't a eureka type thing. It was a more, man, God damn, I'm tired of this shit. Me and my partner Carnell, he own and operate the music page on Instagram, Music Monopoly. Y'all go check it out if you're listening. And we was just on the phone. And, you know, George Floyd had just got killed, Ahmaud Arbery. It was like 3-4 murders, like back to back to back, boom, 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 boom. And we was on the phone talking, and, you know, we like, man, this shit here, man. God damn, man. Fuck. And we was, me and him, big hip-hop heads, we like, man, it ain't nobody saying shit about it. Like, the laws out here killing the shit out of niggas, and everybody still partying like the shit is, like, ain't shit happened, like, music-wise. Like, these niggas still rapping about riding in clean cars and popping bottles and spending money, and niggas out here dying, my nigga. What the fuck? Like, what the fuck happened to hip-hop? Like, hip-hop used to have a soul, used to have a conscience. You know, and that's how the album came about, man. Me and Carnell was having a conversation, and we were like, man, somebody need to do something. Somebody need to say something, my nigga. Like, goddamn, somebody say something. And do you know, motherfuckers was out in the streets marching and burning shit down, and we was like, nigga, the revolution coming, man. It need a soundtrack to the revolution. And we were like, damn, that's a dope-ass title. And that's how it was born right there. And we were like, man, we need to do that.
You know, and when we look at it, Smack, from what has happened, you know, of course, with COVID, you know, that is really given. We had Cassidy on the show some months back. And Cassidy, you know, shout out to the Philly legend Cassidy. You know, he was talking about how, you know, this is a time where a lot of rappers really need to be looking at what's going on. And, you know, like he said, if you're not coming out a better MC than what you were going in, then you've been wasting your time throughout this whole pandemic, because we've seen sickness, we've seen death, we've seen America across the board slow down to where we got so caught up in the hustle and bustle of things that we really at times didn't really pay attention. Well, we always knew, but we didn't give the proper attention to what was going on. And now it's in a situation where we're in a constricted space. We can't move like we once did, where we're just going to ignore shit, you know, because now, especially with, you know,
you ain't going to ignore shit.
Exactly. You know, we're not going to ignore nothing. You know, we can't, you know, and now everybody.
Man, these niggas don't give a fuck. You ain't looked around. You ain't seen. Man, these niggas don't give a fuck. Man, these bitch-ass niggas don't give a fuck, man. They don't give a fuck, my nigga. You give a fuck. I give a fuck. But the niggas we need to give a fuck, they don't give a fuck. The niggas we need to give a fuck do not give a fuck, man.
As soon as they turned it on
and heard us talking this shit off, man, them niggas talking that black shit. Niggas don't give a fuck.
I was going to ask you, for a lot of people who are in those positions of, you know, privilege, because when you do take a stand, you know, it does require a sense of self-sacrifice in terms of what you're willing to give up. Do you feel that a lot of individuals are not willing to make that sacrifice in order to really address what is going on?
Yeah, man, a lot of motherfuckers want to talk that shit, but, you know, them niggas on. They still, you know, them white folks sign their checks. Niggas ain't, and then a lot of niggas just say that shit because it's fashionable. But at the base of it, like, how much are you really for the move? One thing you got to realize is, let's just say revolution jumped off right now today. One thing we got to consider is who really going to be ready for revolution? Who really going to ride for revolution? All these multi-millionaire rich blacks, you think they actually finna give up their power, their clout, their fame, their money for your poor black ass? Like, really think about that. All of them.
Right.
How many of them are ready? Why you think that's why they try to pacify you with telling you shit like, get out and vote? Well, at least you had a voice. You ain't got no voice. Don't nobody, nigga, how the fuck your voice matter when your life don't matter? How your voice, that shit, just think about it. How does your voice matter when your life don't matter? This shit don't make no sense.
You know, and when you have people trying to discount Black Lives Matter, saying all lives matter, I look at that as being disingenuous because I'm like, when you look at situations, you know, when you look at the way that we, you know, the black people lives have been lost, you know, and we've seen situations that it did not have to go there that far, and all we're saying is we're people, and we're not disposable. We're just not someone to just be killed in the street. But then when we speak on these matters, some people will say, well, you know, you're just paranoid. I'm like, no, I'm not paranoid because I've seen what happens to us out there. You know, Ahmaud Arbery.
They know you ain't paranoid. They just, that's their way, the de facto way of them letting you know, man, don't nobody give a fuck about what you feel and your fears. And nigga, don't nobody give a fuck about you and your black ass life. Nigga, fuck your life. Your life is meaningful. We've all been taught, everybody been taught, whether it's true or not, all through high school, that the black life, since it got to America, is meaningless. Your life don't mean shit. This is what they taught us all the way through school.
And when we've seen it reinforced at a lot of graphic levels, you know, in terms of, you know, how, you know, we've seen Rodney King in 1991 when he was beaten. You know, we just seen all these situations. I mean, Eric Garner, you know, it's just time and again.
Your life don't mean shit, man. Your life don't mean shit. Your life don't mean shit to white folks. Your life don't mean shit to black folks, my nigga. Your life don't mean, the only person your life means something to is you and the closest, and your closest loved one. It's some of your family members your life don't mean shit to. They'll show up at your funeral before they show up at your graduation or show up at you celebrating an achievement.
And in terms of where we come to, because a lot of people try to use the, you know, they try to talk about, you know, the situation of, you know, even times to throw away the sense of, you know, well, how come Black Lives Matter don't mean to black people? You know, number one, I wonder why people would even throw that argument in there, because we're not talking about a situation from establishment, you know, homicide that has happened to us. I'm like, this is just me from my observations, because when you talk about black on black crime, you're dealing from a whole different set of circumstances. And Michael Dyson, to me, broke this down so astutely. He's like, this is, you know, black-on-black crime, that he said, was really nothing more than what they tried to come up with, to have a demarcation in terms of the violence in America, where they don't have to address it at large. They can singularly put it in the black community and make it look like, as black people, we are out of control, that we cannot, you know, coexist with each other. But he said, when you look at violence in general, when it does happen, because violence is indiscriminate in who it affects, you know, white people will kill white people because a lot of times white people live in closer proximity to white people. Just like when you have black people that will kill black people because they live in closer proximity to each other. But when you look at the issues in the black community, they are so much more pronounced, because you are already looking at some communities, not all, but some, from a disadvantaged perspective of social strata. You're looking at education. This is something Black people don't talk about, but we should talk about more. Mental health. You know, you're dealing with a lot of mitigating factors that further complicate an already hard existence in America as is, you know, but I still feel that this is not something that we can just dismiss in terms of, no, I'm like, when we're looking at the issue of violence in America, whether race or amongst each other, that's why your music, you know, what you all do, Smack, is so important, because we have to get to the parts of the systemic illness of what is going on in this country's society, and how, number one, we have to address it, and two, how do we solve it?
Yeah. Yeah, that's one of the biggest issues is the solution, you know, and like a lot of motherfuckers get mad at me because I always address the problem, where they like, well, what's the solution? Shit, nigga, if I knew the solution, you know, I got a couple ideas to implement, but to say that you know the complete solution to, you know, to solve every Black person's problem in America, like, that's we can't even start at step one. Because I was talking to my partner, because I done a post about Ice Cube on Instagram. Right. And somebody said, who is Ice Cube? Who is Ice Cube to speak to us? He ain't talked to me. He ain't talked to all of Black America. And I had, because I rarely respond to people on my posts. But every now and then I respond when it provides me with a teachable moment. So when he said that, like, he didn't speak to Black America, I said, dumb nigga, who the fuck is Black America? Who do you consider Black America? He didn't speak to the elites. He didn't speak to the working class. He didn't speak to the impoverished, the uneducated. Who the fuck is he supposed to speak to in Black America? Like, and how many motherfuckers is supposed to be present? Is all of Black America supposed to be present? And how are we all supposed to get online and discuss what's supposed to be in the contract with Black America? Niggas can't even, you could put four niggas in the car and tell them go down the street and order a pizza. Nigga, they'll be sitting there 30 minutes arguing about the toppings to put on a whole ass pizza. But you think that every nigga is supposed to have input. Hey, man, we got to find a starting point, because every nigga ain't going to agree on what they want. Do a poll. How much money you think, if they was to give reparations, how much money do you think you should have? And watch the range of fucking answers and some of the stupidity that you might even see. I could even imagine a nigga saying, man, fuck the money. Just give me a Bentley. I'll be all right.
You know, but you know, Snack, that you hit it right on the head, man. You hit it right on the head, because when you're looking at Black America, you know, that there are so many different experiences in Black America, as we were talking about earlier, in terms of the upbringing and how a lot of us perceive it. You know, you have a lot of, you know, I'm going to go there to a degree, but it's not to be incendiary in any statements I will make. I have that disclaimer in front of it. But when you're dealing with Black America, a lot of times, you know, you're dealing with Black America from an affluent perspective in terms of who was born into upper middle class, i.e. rich. Well, there's rich and there's upper middle class, and then there is, you know, then you have middle class, then you have on a poverty line. So a lot of times, depending on the situations of how your upbringing is, especially because we're speaking strictly from being Black, we're speaking strictly for Black people. When you're born in America being Black, you're a lot of times, this is the one thing that we have to put out there to all Black people, because there is a very, at times, misconstrued and incorrect statement about, well, what is Black life? Black life is what you're born into. Black is who you are as a person. Black does not have a description of what your life is supposed to be. Because people have, even in the tragic cases, we have situations where black people will say, because you didn't struggle, you didn't have an authentic black lifestyle.
Yeah.
Well, who really wants to, yeah. Who? But my question is, who wants to struggle? You know, as black people, what has always troubled me, and I love my black people dearly, I love being black, I have a very concerned view, because we have a skewered, some of us have a very skewered view of what it means to be authentic, you know, in terms of, like going back to the Fresh Prince episode, you know, when Carlton was trying to pledge into that black fraternity.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah,
they were basically calling him a sellout. And the dude was basically, resentful because Carlton had a good upbringing. Now, when we look at Carlton's character throughout the show, he was raised in Beverly Hills. You know, he had a good life. So we saw different, because on the layers of Fresh Prince, they talked about some real shit in that show, you know, because how Carlton, you know, because Will was from the streets of West Philly. So he understood a lot of what went on the street, and Carlton was from an affluent neighborhood in Beverly Hills. So he really didn't understand, you know, black life from a poverty and economically disadvantaged. So he was naive and oblivious to a lot of things, not because he wanted to be, but simply because he never
he was sheltered and he was protected from it.
Right. But one thing about it, but even in that situation, in that episode where him and Will ended up in jail, you know, because that cop ran them in, you know, and Uncle Phil basically had to let that cop know what it was.
Yeah, you know,
because the white man's like, yeah, I know these kids. I told them to bring the car. But, they, you know, Will and Carlton got profiled. And Carlton couldn't figure out what was going on, because Carlton was like, how could we be profiled? But, see, that was something he didn't understand. You know, as black people, I think part of where we have to start our healing with each other is we have to understand each other's plight in terms of legitimately being able to see where the other comes from, in terms of, you know, is from those who are the who are more of the financially, you know, advantaged. We got to look at it from looking at those who did not have the same advantages, and how we have to bring them up. Just like we can't have the ones who are financially disadvantaged hating the others who made it, just like we can't have the ones who made it looking down on the others. You know, because
honestly, that's a struggle within itself, because
you're dealing with
mind state, and you're dealing with breeding, you're dealing with conditioning. We've been conditioned in a certain fashion to, like, let's say that's like, some shit just happened. Actually, just happened in Philly with the young cats in Philly. They over there are warring and shooting at each other. And Meek Mill tried to step in. Shout out to Meek Mill. And he tried to get the young brothers to come to the table and do a truce. And he said, if the young brothers come to the table, he'll help them get record deals and sign them so they can get some money and get their partners out the streets and get their family out the hood and shit. And all of the young brothers turned on Meek Mill, started calling him a bitch ass nigga and a sellout and all this type of shit, because he don't want them out there killing each other and killing up possibly innocent black people in the meantime of them trying to kill each other. And they got mad at him for wanting to be of service to the whole black community in Philadelphia. We dealing with a hell of a mind state, man. We dealing with, because when you separate yourself from that element, they automatically go to looking at you a certain type of way. They go to looking at you like you sold out. Like at the end of at the end of Menace to Society when Kane was listening with Jada Pinkett. And Old Dog told him, "You a whole ass nigga." Because the nigga wanted, he was like, "Nigga, I don't want to lose my life in these streets. Nigga, you a whole ass nigga."
You know, but you know, Smack, when you mentioned that movie, because when Kane was speaking to his OG, and shout out to Glenn Plummer, who played the prisoner who Kane was speaking to, and that dialogue was just, I mean, look, you know, that movie, shout out to the Hughes brothers, because that movie should have won an Oscar. Unbelievable acting. Shout out to
those stories were still new to the world of Hollywood. Like, and plus, you know, black people telling our own stories was still new. What you had people like Mario Van Peebles and his old man telling stories. Melvin. But telling like real hood stories at that time, like with a street narrative, and you know, that was new to Hollywood, man. That was, you know, because you basically went, from Boys in the Hood to Menace to Society. Oh, you had Juice. I forgot. You probably what you had, Boys in the Hood, Juice, then Menace to Society. You know, that was still relatively new to Hollywood. It was like a experimental period.
And then
like,
South Central and Fresh that would come after that too.
Yeah, well, you know, South Central was damn near like a straight to DVD type movie. Fresh was it came out too, but Fresh was a little more intellectual. Like they tried to merge like a little more thought provoking and a little more like strategic. It was street, but they added the element of chess, and you lost a whole bunch. But then, don't get me wrong, it's a bunch of brothers who've been in jail. They play chess, but like, if you ain't just been to the penitentiary or jail, the average nigga don't play no chess on the streets. You know what I'm saying? So they lost a lot of motherfuckers. Even though I thoroughly enjoyed Fresh. I like Fresh. I might go see if they got that motherfucker on Netflix, because I ain't seen it in a while. I like Fresh. I thought it was real innovative.
Look, shout out to Sean Nelson, you know, Giancarlo Esposito, you know, Samuel Jackson, who did a thing in it. You know, M. Boucher, I think M. Boucher Wright was in there, too, before she did
President.
Yeah,
M. Boucher Wright, Fresh was dope, man, but all that shit was still experimental as far as Hollywood went, you know.
Yeah.
Until they actually see
you guys,
like,
think
any
hood movies
we can make money
back
off this shit.
You said what, King?
So you guys think that the era of hood movies are pretty much over with?
Hell no. Fuck no. Niggas make hood movies every day. It's just the way they are being made and the platform they, like, Hollywood ain't giving no money to motherfuckers to make a hood movie. But niggas making hood movies. I was just in one a couple weeks ago. My partners, them down here, they got a movie called Day to Day where they do like 30-minute like series, and they upload it to YouTube. You know, it's a new day. Hood movies ain't going nowhere. Is hood niggas going anywhere?
Nope.
What a hood nigga gonna
it's
do?
Always,
if you take away the hood,
it didn't leave Hollywood. It went back to the hood.
Yeah, like a motherfucker. What is a hood nigga gonna do if you take away a hood movie, man? Have pee and crumpets? What the fuck is we gonna do, Kaker?
we got enough Tyler Perry as it is.
Yeah, you know. And, you know, Tyler Perry, you got Kate Knockham, though. You know that nigga there. He got a bigger goddamn, the biggest sound stage in America. Man went from living in his car to being a legitimate billionaire and you know.
And building his own airport,
story
too.
His story is to be celebrated.
And building his own airport.
Oh, damn, I ain't know that. But, you know.
Yeah, he bossing up, like, man.
You know, a lot of people, what motherfuckers don't got to realize, like, especially in these days and time, nigga, every day we live in history in real time. Like, we live in history. The shit that Tyler Perry done, that was some historical shit. Like, the story might not just be that magnified right now. At the point, the moment he did it, it was a big thing, and then it died down. But that shit is in the history book. Somebody's going to teach that to somebody in 30, 40 years.
Yep.
Hopefully, you know, if they won't wipe the shit out, you know.
Now, in terms of the media perspective, in terms of visuals, tell us about your Black Superhero video in terms of what inspired that.
Oh, Black Superhero? Well, my nigga who produced it, shout out to my nigga D-Botch, and he gave me the beat, and like the beat alone, like, I was like, oh shit, and I knew I had to do something special to it, and it had that old school Curtis Mayfield, like, real funky type. It's funky, and I say, damn, I want to do something, you know. And I hate just doing average, ordinary shit. I like to, because a lot of motherfuckers forgot that, you know, hip-hop is still entertainment. You know what I'm saying? Like, motherfuckers right. still want to be entertained. And so, me and Carnell, my same partner who I came up with Soundtrack to the Revolution with, we was riding down the freeway. And we was riding down the freeway, and I can't remember how we just got on. I was like, damn, and Black Superhero. And when I got home, I just structured the song around that, you know. And then after I got the song recorded and shit, and I like doing videos that's different, something that, like I say, entertaining. I don't like doing no old basic bullshit ass video like everybody doing. So I say, man, I want to do a cartoon. And so it was real simple. It's not no big extravagant story that goes with it. You know, I just wanted to do something different and something refreshing, to, at least to me. You know, but I hope people, like, really enjoy the video and enjoy the concept of it.
Definitely. Now, what's a typical writing session for you like in terms of what inspires you, like, really, in terms of when you're sitting down and you're really putting pen to paper in terms of, you know, the creative process?
Man, I've been doing this shit since I was 11 years old, and I don't have a certain type of way of writing. I've written, like we done Soundtrack to the Revolution. We done all that on the spot. Sometimes I be at the house and writing, and some come to me. Sometimes I got a beat and I write to the beat. Sometimes I go in the studio and freestyle. So I don't have a real set type of way of doing. It's really all about the vibe and, like, whenever I'm inspired. Like, I might hang up with you and a song come to mind and I write it, you know? So I really don't have a certain type of, like, necessity or way of doing things. Like, I could write with a beat, I could write without a beat. I could write on the spot, I could freestyle, you know. So however it comes to me or whatever is necessary at that time, that's just how I approach it.
Wow. So pretty much it just kind of comes, you know, just come, the creative energy just flows pretty much as you just go with it.
Yeah, pretty much, you know. And some, like I say, I've had a dream and seen a song in my dream and hopped up out of my sleep and go to write, trying to hurry up and write down as much of it as I can remember, you know. So, yeah.
Man, look, them sleep writing sessions be something when you just see that bar when you see that structure to rhyme just coming to your head, and you know you got them lyrics, because you know it's a whole different creative process when you're sleeping, when your mind's at peace, and then it's like, then all of a sudden genius strikes, and you're like, whoa, I gotta catch this before I lose it.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Because when I'm really in my mode, like when I'm in creative mode, like I really hate it. I don't hate it, but it's tiresome. Because whenever I, because like I write books, I write movies. I got over 200 movies that I've conceptualized, and I got actual like 8 of them that's actually scripted all the way out. You know, I got 6 books I done wrote. One is actually out, and another one is typed up and ready to be put out. But it's such a beautiful book that I don't want to put it out as a basic unknown, you know, because I don't want, this book shouldn't have to struggle, because it's such a I tell everybody, if I give you this book, if somebody just gave it to you and you read it, the last thing you would think on earth is that a nigga from the ghetto wrote that shit. You'll be like, man, this shit here is like a masterpiece. Like, this is like equivalent to some William Shakespeare type shit. And then a motherfucker be like this, who wrote it? You gonna be like, man, get the fuck out of here.
Man, I mean, look, you'd be among, yeah, literary greats like Herman Melville, you know, Herman Hesse, you know, Charles Dickens,
yeah,
you know, James Ball. I mean, W.B.
Yeah.
Du Bois,
Yeah, I got and I wrote the motherfucker when I was locked up, you know. We was on lockdown. The name of it is Nikkiola. It's based in a imaginary world, an imaginary world named New Terra, and it's like kind of like middle times, like the structure of what the era that they in is like in Middle Ages type. Involved.
King Arthur, the medieval.
Yeah, it's something like this, like close to that, but it's not like based on dragons or magic or anything. But it's about a female she's the first motherfucker to bring female empowerment to a country to a place where it didn't exist.
Hmm.
And she's half black, half white, you know. Well, in the book, I don't label her as half black. Her father is from a dark country, and her mother is from a light country, you know.
Got you.
Yeah, it's not any color. The color is dark and light, but it's not a black and white type thing. But you know, and she's beautiful, and she got the body of a goddess, and she's like, everybody gets enchanted with her, and she like casts a spell on people without even trying. She's a little naive to her own beauty and her own power of persuasion.
Oh, wow.
And her own beauty. She's naive to it. Like, she don't see anything special about herself. And her father from a dark country, her father was from a nation of builders and hunters and you know, like masons and shit like that. Like, they built stuff all over the world. They travel and build stuff all over the world. So he passed that knowledge on to her. And it's a beautiful story, man. And because her grandfather, her lineage goes back to, her grandfather was the general of the army, like, 2-3 generations ago, and he died saving the king, and his only wish was to allow his family to carry out the legacy of the kingdom and to keep the knowledge and not let the knowledge die, and to pass that along through his seeds and stuff. Man, the story is, it's complex, but it's simple, and it's a beautiful story, man. It's about her enlightening people and like really, like, some people look at her and see her as a beautiful airhead until she actually goes to speaking and reasoning with them. And then they find themselves like under her spell and like really like in awe of her. It's a crazy story, man. And I ain't going to give away the ending, but it's a beautiful story.
Right.
If I give away the ending. But, yeah, it's a beautiful story, man. It really is. I blew myself away writing it. And it's parts in it that, you know, and I'm a straight-up thug, but it made my eyes a little watery. I didn't cry, cake-ass nigga. I didn't cry. I didn't drop no tear, but I held it back. But, you know.
No, that's all good. That means you found something. Yeah, you when you write something that poignant, that powerful, that profound, it's all about your emotions being expressed. And good literature is always going to evoke certain emotions. That's just the hallmark of all the great, of all the literary greats, because there's tragedy, there's comedy, you know, there's triumph, you know, there's hardship, you know. You
but
know,
it fucked me up because I wrote it, and when I went back typing it up and reading it, it made me emotional. And I was like, oh, what the fuck? Because I know the story. But I was like, oh, shit, this shit really is good. Because, you know, I didn't feel like it was supposed to make me, you know, like really get so engulfed in it to where I was like, damn. Like, it's a beautiful story, man. It really is, man. It's a powerful story. And it's not just female empowerment, but it's just empowering the human spirit, like the best in all of us, because that was her whole thing. Like, she made motherfuckers tap in to the best part of themselves. Everybody she encountered, she made them tap in to, like, their best self. Even when motherfuckers felt,
I mean, but that's what it is, man, because anything when you do in terms of writing, when you do music, you know, when you're painting, any type of artistic expression is an extension of who you are, because you're not limited to just, you know, yourself. There's always an outlet that you have that really can show people your range of all levels of talent. You know, and I think it's healthy because especially, you know, as humans, we are made to interact. We are made to express ourselves. If we were not allowed to do either, you know, we'd be a monolith in madness because we would never have a wide open space to roam to really show how far we could truly go. I mean, it sounds like it's a fantastic read, and definitely you should get it. I mean, have you taken it to any publishers to see, you know, how they feel about it? I mean, or is it something you're going to try to publish yourself?
I don't. Trying to find a publisher is it's a lot of red tape. And sometimes one of my flaws can be I can be impatient with certain shit. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
Especially shit that I don't just totally grasp. Just right off, and it seemed like you running me around in circles and not giving me straightforward answers. I got a low tolerance for bullshit, you know. And when my bullshit meter goes off, I sometimes I can shut down. And it's really not the healthiest thing to do, but it's like a defense mechanism of mine.
Understood.
You know? Yeah.
Understood. But, you know, one thing about it is you know, in terms of that process, it's just like music, you know, the same way, even though a lot of times with music, it's a lot, you know, all you can do, you know, basically, like we were talking about earlier with social media and how it is now with music, because, you know, you basically, you know, the middleman is out of it now, where you can essentially just do it yourself. You know, writing, it is a little bit more because, you know, writing a lot of times is a very intimate art in itself, and to get people to become fans and, you know, really patron your work in that is something because, you know, my mother, you know, instilled the love in me of, you know, for reading from when I was a child, when I was in her stomach and she would read to me. So I've always had respect for the written word. I'm one of those people, you put a book in front of me,
In terms of the ebooks and all that, I don't do that shit. I'm sorry. I just can't. It's just like with albums. I refuse to do online streaming with albums. No. I'm like, nigga, I will buy your shit if I'm a fan of it. I want a physical copy of it. You know, so I don't do all of that computer shit in terms of media. If I want the book,
yeah,
I can't bet you that.
I haven't ever even tried to read an e-book because I've stuck like you, excuse me, like old school type shit, the turn of the page and you know, it's like you say, it's intimate and the computer is, you know, the more that we advance technologically, the less human we become. So, you know, like reading an actual book is a little more human to me. It holds on to my humanity a little bit, I guess.
Now that's interesting you say that, Matt, because when we were talking earlier about the elements of, you know, the lettering in terms of the acronyms, yes, the acronyms.
Certain things.
Yeah. Now, how do you feel about it in terms? Now, do you think in terms of where we, because social media and, you know, of course, media in general has made everything so expedited, but it's not always efficient in terms of how people really exercise their attention to it? Because when I look online, I see a lot of these dudes spelled, and I'm like, these niggas be dyslexic as fuck. Then you got those pseudo academics that want to get out there and try to act like that they know all this stuff, spelling big words, and even they act like they ain't never seen fucking spell check in their life. And it's like, and then I'm reading, I'm like, what the hell is he trying to say? You know,
I get a bunch of them in my comments, my nigga. That shit there is a headache. Some of them, like. You know, maybe you're trying to type too fast, or you ain't reading what you're typing. Because sometimes
syntax disjointed, no punctuation. It's a new day, man.
Punctuation is obsolete and all that shit. That you know, they you know I seen some shit where somebody had put. Like, if somebody is texting you a message and they use punctuation, periods, and commas and shit that they anal, like, that was their diagnosis of people who text message and use punctuation that they're anal because they so anal that they got to put a period there instead of just continue typing the message out that in their head they got to let you know to pause right there. And then I was like, damn, that is kind of some anal type shit. Like, motherfucker, but you know, what a motherfucker was raised with a certain way of doing things. So, you know, not everybody is willing to give all of themselves, you know, what they've been instilled in them and what they've been taught and what they feel like got them to where they are in life. Like, I've been doing it this way this long, and I feel like I'm all right, so why would the fuck would I give that up, you know, just because society is shifting. But this here works for me. But now since it works for me, but society has chose to change, now you telling me I need to give that part of myself up, or if I don't, it's something wrong with me.
You know, one thing about it, Matt, when I think about this too, because when we look at how, because when I was referring earlier to spelling, because a lot of people too, and this is something that is race neutral, because the ignorance is neutral, because you got people from both sides.
Oh, yeah, ain't no color.
But when we
when
you look at it, there's a lot of phoneticisms in terms of how, because people tend to articulate their spelling through how they think it and how they speak it. So the word, they spell the word out in terms of in their mind and in terms of how they speak the word, but they really don't understand, like, certain grammatical rules, like I before E, except after C, in terms
see,
of
yeah.
style. Yeah. So when we're looking at this, but everybody, but I mean, which is not correct when you spell it wrong, no matter how you do it, you know. But then,
yeah.
like they'll tell you that, oh, you're being, you know, man, you're trying to be overly smart. I'm like, well, no. I mean, there's no right way to do the wrong thing, and I mean, you always want to.
Yeah.
And
if you misspell ceiling, like, oh, I jumped up and touched the ceiling, and your shit say S-I-L-L-I-N. Nigga, what? You know, nigga, what the fuck is you talking about, my nigga? Hold up.
But then they get mad at you when you, but then they get mad. But then when I look at it,
you know,
it's a bigger issue. But when it's a bigger issue, when I see people get upset about things like that, because then they feel like that's an affront to their academics, because it goes back to what I said earlier about how a lot of people's academic backgrounds are. And when you have people that are not heavy on that, some people,
and see,
I've learned.
And see, not
go
to
ahead,
cut
go ahead,
you
please.
Off, but that goes back
go ahead, go ahead.
To what I was, that goes back to what I was saying about a certain way of thinking between classes of black people, when you was talking about the rich got to do for the poor. And like, if you, the same way, the educated need to do for the dumb, but the dumb going to be like, get your bitch ass, oh, nigga, you think you white just because you can spell correctly and speak correctly. Nigga, you think you white, bitch ass nigga, go on.
Now, how do we get out of that paradigm? Because that is definitely an illness in the black community that we – because we've drawn this artificial boundary on what is considered, because being intelligent is non-color. It's about academics that are,
but
because anything
you can apply.
But the
whole thing about it, though, you know the whole thing about it, the dichotomy of that situation, like,
mm-hmm.
in a sense, when a nigga tell you that, like, they ain't lying damn near, because the intelligence that you have fostered have come from what? Come from the white man. So when a nigga said, he's not just totally wrong. As stupid as he is and as dumb as he is, you know, he's not totally wrong. Like, at the base of it, like, okay, that intelligence that you do have did come from a society dominated and engineered by the white man. You see the craziness of it, like the irony of the shit. But
yeah,
you know, this is what we was given. So don't let that be the reason for you to try to just remain being a dumb motherfucker, you know. But you know, that's something I thought about before. I was like, well, a nigga not totally wrong when he say you think you trying to act white, because this is some shit that was developed by white people that we are telling people, we're correcting people on it. You know, if a motherfucker tell you about etiquette, you know what I'm saying, you got to eat this type of way. Bitch ass nigga, hey, you trying to be white, you know what I'm saying? And they developed this way of etiquette, you know, so
yeah,
in a sense,
like
a nigga
the
not totally
the
wrong
fork
and dumb.
And dinner fork. Like
yeah,
the fork and
a nigga
dinner
not
fork.
Totally wrong, you know, yeah, so, you know. Oh yeah, I learned about that shit, and I was on the way to the 12th grade. I ain't know nothing about etiquette and a salad fork and a dinner fork, and you start out and work your way in, and a tablespoon and a teaspoon, and you know how the proper way to cut your meat and all that shit. That.
Nah, we just eat. You know how it is. We just eat. You know,
like a motherfucker, sit down and eat like a motherfucker. And nigga, when they told me in this little etiquette class, it's not polite to eat everything or always leave something on the plate. I'm like, nigga, where they do that at? Where the fuck do they do that at, my nigga? I'm eating everything on this whole ass plate. If it's good, nigga, if it's good, I ain't leaving nothing. A bone, some fat, if it got fat on the meat. But I ain't leaving shit. Nigga, I eat a baked potato, nigga, I eat the skin. That's where the protein at. Nigga, I ain't leaving a motherfucking thing.
You know, but that's one thing about it. I think a lot of times as black people, we have to understand, if we really understand our history, you know, when we go back to Kemet, you know, which is the ancient name for Egypt, you know, we were scholars.
Yeah.
We were scientists. We were mathematicians.
Yeah, the land of
Kush,
all that shit. Yeah.
Yeah, so academia is in us. Now has there been a westernization of our education? There has been, but I'm not in there are all elements of it correct? Not entirely, but I don't think that delegitimizes the elements of what is, you know, access to an advantage. And I think as black
as correct as it may be at the base of it, it's still some dumb shit to say. You know what I'm saying? Like, you're going to let this be the reason that you don't gain knowledge just because it was knowledge, you know, because if you search, you got to start somewhere. If you search enough and search hard enough, the knowledge, that black knowledge, you will find it. You know what I'm saying? But you got to be in search of knowledge somewhere. And if a motherfucker like, oh, go on, nigga, you trying to act white, you don't want black knowledge. You don't want no knowledge. A nigga who say shit like that don't want no knowledge. Nigga don't want no knowledge until he go to the penitentiary. That's when a nigga read a book and finally get some kind of knowledge.
Definitely. Well, look, man, we about to wrap this up, Smackwater. This was a tremendous show of scholarly, hip-hop, social, cultural, you know, proportions. You know, you are welcome.
My
back
nigga, y'all,
time.
What kind of show do y'all got? Y'all don't play no music or nothing?
King has a couple of stuff to be taken care of, and usually he'll have music in the background. But what we did tonight, because usually when we have great discussions like we did tonight, we usually just sit and we just, you know, talk with our guests, you know, and we had a great discussion.
Because I was in my mind, I'm like, damn, they ain't went to a commercial, they ain't played one song. Is they just gonna take this and edit this shit?
When we in the flow, dog, we just go with it. And, you know,
I'm cool with that. I was just wondering. I was like, oh, man, these niggas. But I enjoyed myself. I don't do no two-hour interviews, you know what I'm saying, because I be having other shit going on. But it was a great interview. It was intellectual, and it was, you know, and I'm here for that. I'm here for all that, man. I'm here for that intellectual as well as ignorance sometimes, you know.
Look, you're welcome back anytime. We got to give shout-outs, of course, once again, our sponsors, you know, Buddy Boy Entertainment, Core Financial, Justice Boutique, Dirty Basement Radio, Screwball Radio. We had a tremendous show with Smackwater representing H-Town in Texas. And, yo, man, like I said, you're welcome back anytime. And we about to close it out. Any shout-outs you want to give?
Man, shout-out to the whole soundtrack, to the Revolution family. And shout out to everybody that's trying to wake up and be a better person tomorrow than they was today, my nigga.
Definitely, man. Look, peace, love, Godspeed, man. And on that note, we are out. OTC in the breeze. Yes, yes. Peace.